Good morning, everyone. Welcome. I'm going to ask you, everyone, as best as possible, that we participate and share in the prayers because when we come before God, we are meant to be literally very active. The church gathers, as the church is today, we were never meant to be like a football game in Regina. What's a football game in Regina? 24 super exercised men on the field and 46,000 people with cholesterol problems. That's not how it is. So as best you can, and I'll walk you through this, the worship, best you can to join in the prayers and recognize, we want to, especially the grandchildren, want to recognize that in life, because we live in a culture that's having great difficulty with dying. In life, we need the time of the funeral. Funerals can take many different forms, okay? But we the human, it's for the living. It's for the living we need to do this. And as I told the five daughters, I tease them because I come from a family of boys, okay? Is what families are surprised oftentimes when they gather together like this afterwards is when there's a lot of storytelling is how much laughter there also is. And that's so good. Okay, so good. Deliberately now, and when we gather together, we aren't saying any churchy words. God plays for keeps. This is for keeps. And sometimes with the grade fours, I said, grade fours, do you know what it means to play for keeps? I said, this is what it means for play for keeps. Is when grandma and grandpa go down to Las Vegas, they play for keeps. Oh, the grade fours know exactly what that means, that God plays for keeps. So place yourself into God, in the great mystery of God, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Our opening litany, a litany is a prayer that would be prayed as people walked, usually on a pilgrimage. Somebody would lead, and then everyone else would follow. And your response 8 times is, "Be with me, Lord. Be with me, Lord." Jesus promised to be with those who call upon his name. Trusting in his promise, we pray, "Be with me, Lord." Sure and certain hope of your faithful dead, "Be with me, Lord." Faithful friend in time of sorrow and doubt, "Be with me, Lord." Voice that speaks of to troubled hearts, "Be with me, Lord." Beacon of light in the moments of darkness, "Be with me, Lord." Merciful Redeemer and fountain of forgiveness, enduring strength to all who mourn and grieve. Be with me, Lord. Gentle rest for your pilgrim people. Be with me, Lord. Now, our opening prayer is to prepare ourselves to receive the Word of God. And when the Word of God is shared, this is God coming to us. Let us pray. Father God, we come today to give you your daughter Simone. We pray, forgive all her failings and her sins, and make real the very promises of baptism. May she know you, her God, face to face. And for all of us, family and friends, strengthen us. Deepen our faith in you, our God. And we pray in the name of Jesus and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen. Now, our first reading is a wonderful poem from the book of Ecclesiastes, but it's an old man reflecting on life. It's a beautiful poem. Okay, come, our first reader.
Our reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time.
And now we move in a beautiful way to our faith in the resurrection. Our second reader, okay?
A reading from the first letter to the Corinthians. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation has been in vain, and your faith has been in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified of God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have died in Christ have perished. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. For since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. For as all die in Adam, so all will be made alive in Christ. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ.
Even though we have sung "The Lord is my shepherd" at the very beginning, we're going to pray it because this is one of the powerful, powerful images of what God is really like. And your response four times is, "The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want." Together?
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. Fresh and green are the pastures where he gives me repose. Near restful waters he leads me to revive my drooping spirit. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. He guides me along the right path. He is true to his name. If I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. You are there with your crook and your staff. With these you give me comfort. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. You have prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My heads you have anointed with oil. My cup is overflowing. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. Surely goodness and kindness will follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever. In our life, for all of us, no matter where we are, is God is right very close. And the meaning of our life, and we need, each one of us need to find deep meaning why we're here, is found in God. Now, I'm not sure which country this comes from, but it's from one of the little countries in Africa. Somebody put together a little catechism. A catechism is like a guidebook for your faith, okay? Little guide. And I want you to really pray over the first question. The first question is, why did God make you? Answer, he knew you'd like it. Isn't that beautiful? Think of that. And I want you to enter as best you can into the great mystery of God. We live at a time, as of today, when we're discovering so much about how great the cosmos really is. And the new telescope is sending pictures like you wouldn't believe from literally almost the edge of the cosmos. And I invite you, and I hope you could do this, when it's July, August, and it's really nice, and you're in some place where it's really, really dark at night, and the sky is clear. If you're young enough, lay on the grass. If not, sit in your lawn chair, okay? But just look, just in utter wonderment from where you are. It's 13.7 billion light years to the edge of the cosmos. And there's a lot in between here and the end. This is our God creating. And you personally, are created and loved by God. You are here because of God's great love for you. And that's why I invite you to enter into the mystery of God as we come to say goodbye and farewell to Simon. Do this sharing and breathing in the love of God. The Lord is my shepherd. This beautiful hymn and poem and prayer is nothing sweet. It comes from a time, the farming in that day was sheep. Cattle don't come along, cows don't come along for another 1,000 years, okay? He said, what is God like? God is like the good shepherd. The shepherd in those days lived with the sheep, smelt like the sheep, okay? Knew all his sheep by name. And when you see pictures that they have a staff, or a wooden staff, there's nothing romantic about that at all. That was to beat the coyotes off, because the coyotes would circle around every day. It was cheap calories. He said, what is God like? God is the good shepherd who's with us and protects us. And that's why as we say goodbye to Simon, say goodbye in a beautiful way with the great love and the mercy of God. Now, our God, and everything we say about God just limps. You've run across, and I've run across, too many people who are offended. They think that the way they speak about God, they got it down in their pocket. No. This is the best I can do today. That's it. That's the best I can do today to speak about God. Hopefully in 10 years I can do much better, because God is a God of great mercy and incredible love. And we want to enter into and share that mercy. Now, I was deeply moved a few weeks ago. And Pope Francis, in one of Pope Francis, gives many, many talks, many groups. But he used one powerful image that really moved me about the mercy and the goodness of God. He quoted an experience from the holy priest from 150 years ago in France, called Jean Vianney, very, very holy man. And in those days, the interpretation was that if someone committed suicide, ended their life, there could be no salvation. We know that there was the wrong interpretation, because we know that when people are so desperate, they don't want to end their life, they just want to end the pain. A husband had jumped off the bridge. And the widow came to the holy priest, Jean Vianney, and she was very concerned about his salvation. And this is, I'm deeply moved by this. Jean Vianney said to the wife, "Remember, between the bridge and the water is the mercy of God." That's so powerful. It's the mercy of God. God was good. Gave us Simon. We today are going to give Simon back to God. But in a God filled with great mercy. And then the next step is not just that we receive God's mercy, is that we give mercy to each other. In all our families, in all our workplaces, wherever we are, we all need, because we're broken people sometimes, quite often, we all need a lot of forgiveness and healing. Take the mercy of God, take the mercy of God, and truly give to one another. Now, as part of our time of prayer, we're going to take the stuff of Simon's life, and after each of them, I'd ask you all to respond. And then we'll have a time of silence. The silence is for you and I to give Simon to the Lord, okay? But your response is, "We thank you, Lord." Father God, we are thankful for the patience that Mom showed having gone through many adversities in life to raise 5 strong, independent women. We thank you, Lord. Compassionate God, we are thankful that even though there were struggles, Mom always made sure everyone was taken care of before herself. Life-giving God, we are thankful Mom loved coffee time and social visits with friends. She enjoyed playing card games and nickel bingo. Mom loved walking, going to concerts in the park, doing her word search books, watching The Price is Right. Mom enjoyed toe-tapping to old country music and often could be seen on the dance floor doing the two-step. Mom loved her sweets and usually chose to eat her first dessert first before her meal. She often asked for a second helping of dessert after her meal was finished. God of family, we thank you for Mom being so independent and strong-minded. In her years at Providence Place, you would often see her zooming down the halls in her wheelchair, and you better watch out. Her favorite saying was, "Okay, let's go." Thank you, Lord. God of grandchildren, we thank you for the love of her grandchildren and her great-grandchildren. She enjoyed spoiling and spending time with them. She never missed a birthday. She was very proud of all her grandchildren and always attended school activities and sporting events. We thank you for keeping your pantry stocked with snacks and goodies. And now in the silence, as you bring your eyes to her coffin, to her brother, each one of us gives Simon to the Lord. When you know, and we want people to know, we know the source and the origin of the Lord's Prayer. In our culture, we have too much Lord's Prayer, too much, okay? And we don't appreciate what it, or understand what it really means. When Jesus dared, the very carefully chosen words, when Jesus dared to name God in his language, Abba, in English we try to translate it as the Good Father, he got into deep, deep trouble with the religious leaders. Because if God is truly Father, then everyone is sister and brother. They despise the people, the peasants, okay? To say the Lord's Prayer honestly is extremely radical. Be brave. If you're with Jesus and want to be with Jesus, let's pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Faith, our faith gives us incredible strength for the terrible things that happen in life. We're going to sing the words of Scripture from God, "Be not afraid." Now, you may be familiar with the hymn, may not. But in my life, because I spent around the Saskatoon area many, many years, okay? In the University Hospital in Saskatoon, it happened to me every time. You drive up, now I'm complaining. You try to find a parking spot. Okay, you get your vehicle parked. And then as I walked, there's a long corridor going into the University Hospital Mall. As I walked down this long corridor, every time the hymn came to mind, "Be not afraid," because I wonder how many people, my own relatives, have walked down that corridor, not sure what they're going to find at the other end. Great courage. We'll stand. We'll sing "Be Not Afraid," okay? And now we come to the prayers of asking, the prayers of the faithful. Your response is, Lord, hear our prayer. Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and lives always to intercede for us. With confidence we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. Savior of the human race, you triumphed over sin and death. Give our mother Simone a share in your victory. We pray to the Lord. Judge of the living and the dead, you are merciful and forgiving. Embrace our mother with your tender love. We pray to the Lord. Light of the world, you've called Simone from death to life. Surround her with the light of the heavenly city. We pray to the Lord. Anointed one of God, you summon Simone to be your disciple. Give her the crown of her faithfulness. We pray to the Lord. Caring and gentle Lord, you share the burdens of those who mourn. Give us your gifts of comfort and peace. We pray to the Lord. Son of God, you have the word of everlasting life. Open our ears to hear your voice and deepen our longing for the coming of your kingdom. We pray to the Lord. And in silence, and I know in your life, there are people that you are very concerned about. You wake up at night. You wonder where they are, how they're doing. Okay? Name them to the Lord now in silence. Name them to the Lord. Pray for them. And now, Holy God, hear all our prayers, those we spoke aloud, the few that are many that cry out in our hearts, for you are truly our God, our great God, in Christ Jesus and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Now, the final prayers over the body of Simone, we are very earthy people, okay? And we want to stress God became human. God became flesh, a working man, just like you and I, suffered the heat, suffered clients collect his invoices, okay? God was really human. And we have a big word called incarnation. We call that the incarnation, okay? Now, what that means is God came and asked Mary, a young woman, 14 or 15, because that was the marriageable age in those days, to be mother. And we know that Mary struggled and Mary accepted. Now, in theory, every woman here, you could be asked to be mother of God. You'll say, I never thought of that. Now, when I'm up front here, I see a few things that you will never see. A few years ago in Prince Albert, I said, folks, if your daughter is 14 or 15, okay, your daughter could have been asked to be mother of God. Third bench, four in, I saw a couple turn to each other like this. They weren't believing that one. But that's what it means to, God became flesh so that the God could be in our flesh. And so the final prayers over the body of Simone is to recognize that you are, Simone, you are joined to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ lives in you. May you truly know the resurrection and know your God face to face. Okay. Before we'll go our separate ways, let us take leave of Simone. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. And now we profess our faith, and three times you say, in my flesh I shall see God my Savior. In my flesh. See God my Savior. I know that my Redeemer lives, and on the last day I shall rise again. And in my flesh I shall see God my Savior. I myself shall see him, my own eyes gaze on him. And in my flesh I shall see God my Savior. This is the hope I cherish in my heart. And in my flesh, I shall see God, my Savior. And I'm going to take the holy water, sprinkle her body with the holy water to remind ourselves, Simone, you were baptized for God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And for all who are baptized, even if you don't live it or live it poorly, Feel the Spirit of God in your toes, in your elbows. Know this, God is in you. Let us pray. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our mother, Simone, our grandmother, in the sure and the certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for all the blessings which you bestowed upon Simone in her life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with Simone forever. Immediately afterwards, we are all going to walk straight across to do something wonderful. We're going to have coffee and food together. This is a very important part of the funeral time, very important part. It's very good. Thank you to our organist and to all the readers. And listen to the last words, because they're very appropriate. Dear family, dear friends, may every mark of affection and every gesture of friendship that you give to one another be a sign of God's peace for you. In peace, we'll take Simone to her final place of rest. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay. We'll sing the concluding, you know the hymn very well, Amazing Grace. We'll sing three verses of it, okay? We'll stand for that, okay?